Greetings, how are you doing? Troy Brown here, back with another video on how to improve weak body parts. Sounds like a great idea. I know a lot of us over the years, no matter what age we are, have one, maybe two stubborn muscle groups that just, you know, for whatever we do, they just don't improve, right? And I want to talk about this and how you can build them up over time. We can actually improve these muscle groups, but it's understanding some things first. But before I go into that, I want to digress a little bit and just talk about the issue that I had when I was competing. In my earlier days, I always found that my legs were very strong. I had good leg development, but my upper body was non-existent. I lacked fullness in the shoulders. My back was very flat. My chest was really, really flat. So it wasn't till 2003, I hired a new coach and his name was Harold Marulier. He's in England. And he told me something that I'm going to share with you. And Flex Lewis actually did this too, around about the same time when we were competing against each other. So one thing Harold told me was the nutrition that you're consistently eating day after day, week after week, month after month, when you train your legs, keeps going to your lower body. So he said to me, why not back away from your leg training and your volume and use that nutrition where it needs to go, which is my upper body? So I said, you know what? I've got nothing to lose. I am coachable. I am trainable. I am teachable. I'm going to do exactly what you say. So I did for a whole year. I didn't train my legs for a whole year. Sure, did I stimulate them now and again? Absolutely. But the point is that I did exactly what he said. And I noticed that the upper body started to improve. So if this is you, maybe you are like myself and Flex Lewis. If you look at his pictures back in the day when he was up and coming, he had world-class legs even as a teenager. And his coach at the time told him to do exactly the same thing, take a year off. And that's what he did. And look what he's created, right? His upper body flows beautifully. So my point is, if this is you, if you're in that same predicament, maybe it's the opposite for you. Maybe you want to improve your leg development. Maybe your upper body is really strong. Then I would encourage you to take a look at your nutrition and also look at your training and maybe pull back on those stronger body parts, reduce the volume, or do what we did. You know, take some time away, take 6 weeks off, maybe take 3 months off, maybe 6 months, maybe a year, who knows? But the point is to really understand that in order to bring up a weak body part, we got to know some variables. And number one, the key to the vault is you need to understand this, is that a weak body part is the result of how your body moves at a default mode. What I mean by that is that when you go into the gym and you're trying to target a certain muscle group, are you actually targeting that specific muscle group? Think about it. You know, are you going in the gym and can you actually feel that stubborn muscle group? A lot of people have issues with rear delts, right? Let's use that as an example here. Is my hand and my elbow joint lining up with that rear delt? You know, wherever your rear delt inserts, the body tends to work best in straight lines, right? So it's all these little things, like these little details, make a huge difference long term. Let's break this down to the fundamentals, right? We can't build a house on shaky foundation, right? In order to build a house, we got to get stable, right? And I've spoken about stability before, but I don't really want to talk about that today. But I do want to talk about the most fundamental piece that I think a lot of us need to go back to when improving a stubborn muscle group, is to really think about, we obviously want to improve that particular muscle group, but we have to do this. In order for a muscle group to improve, that stubborn muscle group, we have to change the forces of that particular muscle group that it's been subjected to. So we have to change the force. So let's use, I don't know, for me in my career, I talked about my upper body being really weak. I've got very short clavicles. So for me to get width in my shoulders, I had to really pay the price on getting my medial delts to really respond. And that meant that I had to change the forces. Back in the day, I always did lateral raises with a bent arm approach. That didn't work for me. They just didn't grow. And it wasn't till I actually learned that I had to maybe straighten my arms away and get my hands further away from me as much as possible and understand that where the insertion lies. The insertion lied for me at the time, and it still does, obviously, is my insertion inserts around the front. So that meant that instead of doing a conventional lateral out to the side, I had to bring the arm in front a little bit more to activate that medial head. And you might have to do the same thing. So it's just really changing the forces that of that particular muscle group that it's been subjected to. Maybe a reason for you, maybe your legs won't respond, is because when you back squat, you're 6'2", you have a long femur and a long tibia, as an example. And when you squat, the load tends to go to your glutes and lower back. So here's what I'm trying to say. Not all movements fit all of us. We have to really look at and understand that, does an exercise really fit my body type? And as we age, our body does change. So the things that we did in our 20s and 30s, you have to say, well, is it really going to work for me in my late 30s and 40s and 50s and beyond? So it may mean that we might have to start over, and that is okay. I think that's the beautiful thing about this game of muscle building that we're all in, is that we all want to get better. And I think in order for us to get better, what we do, and I hold my two hands up, I'm very open about this, is that in order for a muscle to grow, we think we got to train it more frequently, and we have to train it heavier. Go heavier, do more. Boom, injury. So I want to eliminate that. There's other ways of progressive overload, right? We can increase the time, the duration. We can increase the reps. We can increase the tempo. And one of the biggest things I love to do with certain clients is to increase the distance. Let's say your chest is weak. Maybe you got to get back into scapular retraction and create more distance. So you can create that range becomes much greater. All these little things, right? Remember what I said, we have to change the forces that the muscle's been subjected to in order for it to grow. And this is what we all have to get back to. So sometimes, I admit it, we got to get that ego out, right? And we may have to drop the weight a little bit. But I think the fundamental piece that I want to hit home here is we've all got to get back to, you've heard it before, a lot of great coaches and gurus talk about it, is getting back to form and execution. If you've missed anything, please don't miss this part. This is probably the most important piece, is that you've got to understand that, are you really and truly executing the repetitions the best of your capability with that particular muscle group? What you might be doing is you might be swayed subconsciously towards people that have phenomenal physiques and doing exactly what they do. And that might not be a good idea, because they have maybe a different structure than you. For example, doing a bent over barbell row like someone does on Instagram who's a fitness influencer that you respect, you try it and it might not activate the muscle groups that you want, and the muscles just don't respond. Obviously, you've got to put time into your equation too, but we've got to look at, does those particular exercises fit our structure? And if it doesn't, we need to change it. So it may mean doing what I did, investing in a coach to get them and be coachable and trainable and teachable, and get them to look at your structure and put together the right movements that are going to fit your body type. But it won't matter until we go back to form and execution. So it's like walking into a gym, and the first thing that needs to come on the impression of our subconscious mind is form and technique. We have to go in there and understand that, yeah, being strong, lifting heavy weights is part of it. But as we age, we also have to realize that maybe using a dumbbell might not be the best thing to activate that posterior delt, as an example. I might have to use a cable to get constant tension. But making sure also, and I'll touch on it earlier, was the stability piece. Am I stable enough in order to still keep building muscle? Are my shoulders moving around when I'm training that rear delt? This is an important thing to understand. Maybe when you're trying to bring up your legs, how stable are you? Are you a little wobbly? Are you a little bit shaky on the way down eccentrically? That plays a huge factor in building muscle. So what you would need to do, instead of keep doing more heavier weight, train more frequently, is actually to get more stable. And this was a question that came to me actually last week. I do a weekly email. And in this weekly email, I just give tips and tricks on muscle building and fat loss and to improve your physique as we age. And the reply I got was, over 40 years of training with this individual, he still can't bring up his calf development. So he believes that he should be training calves every single day. And that could be right because calves are a stubborn muscle group, right? But at the same time, is he really challenging the soleus? Is he really challenging the gastrocnemius? And if not, then what he might need to do is get a video from maybe different angles, facing the front, facing the side, facing the back, and send them to somebody that can critique him and just being honest. And here's the thing, I don't know everything. I actually don't know nothing when it comes to this. I'm just a student of the game. I want to keep learning. Hence the reason why I'm jumping on here. I'm practicing. I'm practicing the way I speak. I'm practicing the way I'm trying to communicate with you, and I can always get better. So if you always have that mindset that you think you know everything, it won't really serve you. And we can still learn good habits in our 40s and 50s and 60s. So as I bring this in for a landing, remember, number one, a weak body part is a result of how our body moves in a default mode, which basically means, are you actually activating and targeting and feeling that particular muscle group? Number two, a weak body part is a result of how our body moves in a default mode, which basically means, are you actually activating and targeting and feeling that particular muscle group? Number two, if you finally want to improve that weak body part, change the forces it's been subjected to. You know, it brings me to an awesome quote that I talk about all the time on these videos is Buckminster Fuller. He was responsible for the geodesic dome. And he says, and I quote, "You never change things by fighting existing reality. To change something, you build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." And as we age, we start to get more closed-minded sometimes. Sometimes people are trying to get a good idea in our minds, and our minds are just sealed shut. And we can't put a good idea in our mind even if we try. We couldn't even open up with a crowbar. And I say that with honesty, and I say that with love, and I say that to you coming from a humble space, is that going in the gym and thinking that you need to train more frequently, you need to train heavier, might not be the best idea. Here's an example. If you are on the leg press and you're trying to bring up your quads. Another thing, like stubborn muscle group, like one side is more developed than the other, right? For me, my quad was always more developed than my right quad. So what I would do when I'm on the leg press, as an example, even hack squats, is from a neuromuscular standpoint, I would send a signal to that particular muscle group, which is my right side, and really focus on that side more as opposed to my left side. Same thing with your arms too. Unilateral work is important. Yeah, doing one leg at a time, or from a bicep standpoint, doing a single arm is a good idea. But also, if you're doing a conventional EZ bar curl or a barbell curl, if you can get, you know, supinated position, if you can supinate all the way around, that is from a barbell curl standpoint, then what we need to do, if that weaker arm, you know, if it's smaller, then what we need to do is maybe send that signal up here to generate more force on that weaker side. All these little things play massive, can give you more momentum, and you may start to see some progress with those particular muscle groups. So what I'm trying to say, I think, is the best athletes from a hypertrophy standpoint understand about the feeling tone of certain movements, and they don't really sometimes worry about load, even though being strong has its time and a place, but they understand that you have to feel the movement and you have to challenge the muscle. And as we age, we've got to do things right. We've got to go in the gym, or we've got to understand that form and execution is right up there with oxygen. It's the most important thing that you can do at any age. So I would encourage you, as I bring this in for a landing, is to think about, is my form and execution where it needs to be? And if not, what am I willing to do to change it? Because if I keep doing the same thing, it's either going to force me to take one step forwards or two steps back, or I could potentially get injured. So really have a think about your training and look at it and get a bird's eye view, because I really believe that's where you are developing your best self. It's the pursuit of excellence. You're going in the gym with integrity. I call it muscle integrity. And you do everything with precision. And that brings me back to the point of the regularity of the stimulus, meaning Do all my repetitions look the same? And more importantly, am I stable? Because you can't build a house on shaky foundation. Anyway, that's it for me. I hope you got value from this particular video. And if not, if it's a bunch of BS and you don't want to hear this English dude from London, Cockney geezer, who's got a gold tooth, if you think he's chatting nonsense, don't worry about it. Hey, but it might benefit someone else. If it benefits you and you got value from it, please subscribe to the YouTube channel. I appreciate it from my heart. And also leave a comment, positive or negative. All comments are welcome. I appreciate you for taking the time to watch this video. And I'll see you back on the next video, my friend, next week. Cheerio. Take care.